everybody. Hello, Elizabeth.
Hello to you. Hello, everybody.
So we have so much to talk about, and I know that we have so much that we want to hear from Elizabeth. I'm as anxious as anyone to hear after reading, after following her literary career for such a long time and being an admirer, and also after reading and bearing witness to the light of the world, which I think is such an extraordinary work. Reading Light of the World was really satisfying for me because I'm one of those readers that really sees prose and pictures. And I think the idea that we are reading a writer's recollection of her extraordinary life with a painter is really satisfying for me on a lot of levels. And so I really hope to get into that. We're actually going to have a conversation in four movements. And those movements are Ficre, Light, Lottery, and the Hawk, Lucidity and Grief, Seeing and Derek Walcott, and Poets and Presidents. And all of these are themes that I think play throughout your life and this work in particular. And so I just want to get right into it, and I'm going to try to just read a little bit from an article in The New Yorker. In a cemetery in New Haven, Connecticut, there is a gravestone of red India marble etched with words and images from paintings by the man buried there. Quote, "I wake up grateful for life is a gift," end of quote, and the likeness of an angel. Nearby is a bench of the same stone, also etched with words, these from a Derek Walcott poem. O beauty, you are the light of the world. And that's a title of Elizabeth Alexander's powerful and haunting memoir. And in the memoir and in the life of her late husband, Ficre Gebreyesus, we get a chance to see more about the beauty of someone whose intellect, whose vitality, whose kindness, whose love of cooking that is so beautifully displayed in both your recollections of meals, of snacks, and of recipes. We really get a chance to think about grief. We get a chance to think about longing. We get a chance to think about loss. And so I want to start with that. I want to start with Ficre, and I want to start about something that we spoke about. I also lived in New Haven on and off during the time that you and Ficre were there and married, and even before you were married to Ficre, I remember Cafe Ajalis being such a hub, such a meeting point for those of us who were at university there. Can you talk about Ficre and his love of both cooking and painting?
Well, he was an extraordinary human being, and maybe even I'll just start by reading, because that will give us a way into the story. The story seems to begin with catastrophe, but in fact began earlier and is not a tragedy, but rather a love story. Perhaps tragedies are only tragedies in the presence of love, which confers meaning to loss. Loss is not felt in the absence of love. The queen died and then the king died is a plot, wrote E.M. Forster in The Art of the Novel. But the queen died and then the king died of grief is a story. It begins on a beautiful April morning when a man wakes exhausted and returns to sleep in his beloved 13-year-old son's trundle bed, declaring, "This is the most comfortable bed I have ever slept in." Or it begins when the wife says goodbye to the man a few hours later, walking in front of his car, switching her hips a bit, a blown kiss as she heads to her office and he continues on to his painting studio. Or the story begins as he packs a tote bag with the usual slim thermos of strong coffee made in an Italian stovetop mocha pot. The tote bag is astral blue and printed with Giotto angels. Off to his studio for a day of painting, then home as if nothing extraordinary has happened, when in fact he has been envisioning worlds. Hanging the Giotto bag on a hook in the mudroom and changing out of his paint-splattered jeans into gym shorts and a t-shirt for yoga in the family room or a run on the treadmill in the basement. Soon the two children will walk down Edge Hill Road from the bus stop like burrows under their knapsacks, and his wife will prepare dinner while listening to Thelonious Monk's evocative open intervals and sipping from a glass of white wine that he's opened and poured for her. "My frosty white?" she'd ask a few times a week, and he'd chuckle and say, "Right away, my love. Chop, chop." They enjoyed playing and acting out boy-girl courtliness. The 13-year-old does his homework. The 12-year-old practices his drumming. The man's home life is the unchanging, beautiful same. So anything could occur in the painting studio each day. And so it goes on. Perhaps the story begins with the 36 lottery tickets he bought 2 days before he died, which I discovered weeks later when they fluttered out of the pages of one of the many books he was reading. Or it begins with his surprise 50th birthday party 4 days before he died, and the spoken tributes from his loved ones, and strawberries and pancakes and music the next morning. Or it began when I met him 16 years before. That was always a good story, an actual coup de foudre, a bolt of lightning, love at first sight. I felt a visceral torque, I would tell people, a literal churn of my organs, not butterflies, not arousal, rather, a not unpleasant rotation of my innards as never before. Lightning struck and did not curdle the cream, but instead turned it to sweet silken butter. Lightning turned sand into glass. The story began in the winter of 1961 when two quietly mighty women were each pregnant, one in Asmara, Eritrea, the other in Harlem, USA, one with her sixth child, one with her first. And so, there's a lot that's in there, but an extraordinary human being, someone who I hasten to say, especially where we find ourselves right now, was a refugee to this country.
Right.
Was a refugee to this country and came to this country, and I've been talking about this as much as I can. Mm-hmm. He was my refugee. He was New Haven's refugee. He was a refugee who came here and built a restaurant that transformed that town for 16 years with his brother. He was a refugee who came here and made 882 paintings and many, many, many photographs, an artist of great consequence. He was the kindest, most beautiful soul that anyone ever knew. And so, there is what he was to me personally, and how I was able to make my life with him, and why I took us to the end of that passage is, we would marvel that halfway around the world at the same time, two women could be pregnant with children who would one day find each other, but that it happens every day if we let it happen, if we don't shut ourselves off from other human beings. Yeah. We need to say that all the time, every day. We cannot shut ourselves off from other human beings. We cannot imagine that national borders have anything to do with humanity and what we have to give each other. And we also cannot think that, the story of Fikre is a gorgeous story of America having the capacity for all of this beauty, all of this power, all of it uniquely mixed in this place. That someone could come speaking. He spoke 8 languages. He could say thank you in 25 languages because he believed that you should know how to say thank you to people. He was a restaurant guy, so he learned Spanish in the kitchen so he could communicate with people. He came with languages of the world because, again, we have our different tongues, but how do we reach each other? How do we speak to each other? And what does it mean to exemplify that kind of openness? And I think that, it's so moving to me to remember that you knew him too, because, I wrote a book about a beautiful man, but, he was a beautiful man, and that beauty radiated outward, and the beauty and the knowledge and the desire to teach with his food, with his art, with his space, he never hoarded anything he had. And again, to think of that, what do you learn from someone who walks out of his country when he's 16 years old?
Yes.
Because there are killing squads and there are soldiers coming into his home, right? What does it mean to come with a mentality that says you share what you have? And sometimes, like the beautiful book, Frederick is the mouse, the Leone book. And Frederick is the one, everybody, all the little mousies are storing the corn and they're saving for the winter. And Frederick is daydreaming. And then when the winter gets cold and they've eaten up all the corn, Frederick has stories. He's able to paint a picture for the people in his community. You share what you have. So I'm not preaching, actually.
Right.
I won't diminish it in that way. I'm saying what actually I feel is very, very important about of the million things, you know, starting with my sons, but that I learned from this human being that I'm so grateful could come into my life.
So there's so much in there. And one of the great things, I was hearing some chuckling, one of the great things about having this conversation in a library is that everybody gets the literary references, right? Or at least most, most people do. And this is such an important and delicious a book because it really takes us both through the small p political, the everyday politics of the decisions that we make, and to the larger P, the big P, and I think we're alive in that time, and I definitely want to spend a lot of time thinking about that today, and I think that we're going to find our way into that conversation as well in the book. But one of the things that I want to think a little bit about is I want to talk about the kitchen, and I want to talk about cooking, and I want to talk about all of those worlds that come together, migration stories in the kitchen, but I also want to think about that the duality of what work looks like, to cook for a living, to make a living, and in Fikre's case, to paint and to make pictures, to make a life. And I think that that's something that you're speaking to too, because when we're building these walls that we're talking about so much these days, we're also talking about a circumscription that happens around people's lives that really impacts our own and how we live and how expansive our life can be. Can you talk specifically about Café Ajulis and food and Fikre's work in building that restaurant, and also the idea that Ajulis, and I just realized that through your book, means city of men.
City of free men.
City of free
men. Yes, yes. Well, sometimes I think that if we talked about food and cooking and if we cooked for each other and talked about how we knew to cook what we cooked, that everything would be fine in the world. Because I think, you know, all culture and knowledge and mother wit is contained in our food, and food is also a place where there's great possibility, not just for what we think of as purity, but also for recombination. Yeah. So he came from Eritrea, Eritrea being a very interesting place as far as food goes, because the Italians colonized it for a period of time, which introduced to the cuisine, which if you think about injera and stews and so forth, the tomato, they had a coastline, so they had fish, and pasta. So so this cuisine, as he brought it to this restaurant in New Haven, was also his own fantasia. And the book has a lot of different recipes told in different recipe voices.
Thank you.
Oh, well, you know, and it's good food as well. So curried red lentils, you know, and talking about that in the context of Coptic Christians and seasons of Lenten vegetarianism and, you know, how that dish came to be. Or an astonishing dish called shrimp barca, which he invented, and people would leave the restaurant and they would go, sometimes they would travel and they'd end up in Eritrea and they'd order this dish, and the people look at them and say, like, it doesn't actually exist. It, you know, he made it up, because the kind of imagination that can put things together and that believes in putting things together thought, what happens if you put coconut and shrimp and dates together into one dish and mix that with basmati rice and see what you come up with? And what he came up with was sort of a fairy food that literally, I mean, it was kind of, you know, we'd know that every few months someone would call from St. Raphael's Hospital or Yale New Haven Hospital, and they would have just had a baby, and they'd be like, okay, well, now this is what I want to eat. They've been waiting for it.
First postpartum meal has to be from Café Ajulis,
But I mean, I think that, you know, the opportunity that, you know, that we are always cultural people, and that even in our everyday acts, we are bringing our culture to each other. And so I think that, that he saw his cooking, and, you know, but again, war interrupts many things and makes narratives sometimes not what you think they are. So, you know, working in a restaurant was not what he was raised to do. You know, they thought, okay, you go to Italy, you'll study, you'll be an architect, that will be the plan, but war got in the middle of that. So what happens when you come to this country? Well, they'll hire you in the kitchen. Right. And to make something out of that, and to build something out of that, and to think of it as being continuous with creative self-expression. Excuse me, I'm a little sick today. So, you know, that kind of creative self-expression when it, he was always painting, but there came a point many years into the restaurant work where he shifted to focus more on the work of painting.
I want to talk about his paintings because one of the things that I did know being a graduate student in New Haven is I knew Fikret as a photographer. I didn't know about his painting. Mm-hmm. And after reading your work, I went to do some research to see what I could find, and I thought, not only is he a painter, he's an important painter, mm-hmm. Because he really has something to say. But one of the things that's really remarkable, and we're going to talk about his painting and what's happening with it now, where people might have an opportunity to see some even online of his work. So I want to talk about his largesse, because there's something that is that strikes me that today, no matter you know where you are, we're talking a lot about our divide and our division, mm-hmm. and how loss of opportunities make people shrink. It makes our heart probably more angular than round. Mm-hmm. And what we see is that Fikret is a child of war. He has lost a sibling. He you know, has a family that whose diaspora is now all over the world. And through his work, even if you never had an opportunity to meet him, you can't help, through the pages, you can't help but feel that largesse, that generosity towards everyone and his approach to life. Why that when he really had every reason to not feel that way?
You know, I guess I think, I mean, that's a great question, but I want to interrupt the idea that I think a lot of people have, that is that you don't have as much when you've lost a great deal. I think that to remember, you know, before war and before death squads and before disappearances, there was family, there was village, there was beauty, and that remained, that actually those beauties, that love, that force, that backbone, that ancestry, is not something that can actually ever be taken from him or from anybody. So I think that the difference was that he had an artistic sensibility, that meant that he had a language in which to give that out to the world, and also developed the skills with which to give them out to the world. That made me think of a little passage I want to read about generosity, this topic that you bring up. And this is, the book is written in sections. He passed away very, very suddenly just after his 50th birthday. And so we hear that first in the book, then we go back 16 years before and fall in love, and then we move forward through different stages of post-grief, grief and post-grief. And so this is a later stage, and the I is me. About generosity. I begin to feel I am carrying around a Santa sack of gifts because of all the things I know that Fikret thought and felt. I know these things, just me, only me. He gave them to me every single day, all day. I was his person. He told me everything he thought. I run into one of the town yoga instructors in a coffee shop, reach into my invisible bag, and tell her how much Fikret respected her teaching, the care of her adjustments, how he came home one day from her class thrilled that he had done a headstand for the very first time. I run into a neighbor and tell her Fikret thought she was beautiful and foxy and had planned to make butterscotch pot de creme sprinkled with fleur de sel to delight her when she and her husband next came for dinner. I tell her about how amazed he was by the sous vide egg she made when we ate at their home, an egg with an unctuous yolk and a crisp panko and smoked paprika exterior, like nothing he had ever seen or imagined. I tell a colleague from the music department how much he enjoyed talking to her about her expertise on the gamelan as they waited for the kids at the music school. Gamelan, didgeridoo, karari, the world's musical instruments fascinated him, and he always wanted to learn one or the other, I tell a friend. Fikret loved the conversation you had at the natural food market with him, I say, about the basketball player Jeremy Lin's winning streak with the New York Knicks, Lin's sanity, which captivated our house for the few weeks it lasted. Fikret believed utterly in your gifts, I offer, to a niece who is finally pursuing the arts as we always thought she should. Fikret told me you were the mother he would most trust with our kids, the only house where he would let them sleep. Fikret didn't usually like potato salad, but he would happily eat your potato salad every day. Fikret loved you like a sister. To poet friends, Fikret kept your book in the studio, and we had a tug of war when your most recent collection came out. He swiped it from my bedside table. There is one friend I have not yet told. He was reading your book on the day that he died. It was the last book he read. So, you know, generosity, we live that way or we don't.
Yes, we live that way or we don't. Yeah. Absolutely. I want to talk about the paintings, and I also want to talk about some of the images. Lottery, and I'm hoping everyone here, if you don't have this book, I think that it's so expansive that, you know, I'm hoping everyone here will arrive at it one way or the other. But one of the, in addition to Fikri's paintings, one of the images that kind of keep coming up again are of both the lottery tickets, finding mm-hmm. them, and the hawk, mm-hmm. Who appears a couple of times. And there's also a video that Fikri captures of the hawk. As we move into to talking about Fikri's paintings themselves, can you just talk about those images? Because they really move this narrative along in a way that they serve and function in so many ways for the reader.
Well, there's the late art historian Sylvia Boone, who wrote about ideals of female beauty in Western Africa, great art historian. She wrote a terrific book before she became a scholar about traveling to West Africa. Fikri is from East Africa, she was talking about West Africa. And it's a very fanciful, beautiful, beautiful book. And one of the things she said is, when you travel, wherever you go, always buy a lottery ticket. You will not be there for the drawing. So it means that it's not about winning, but it's about believing in luck and believing that there are things that we don't know about and there are surprises always around the corner. And so, you know, the strange thing in the book, so Fikri was one of these lottery ticket people, and we would have these, you know, sort of magical, rational arguments back and forth. I'd say, like, okay, you know, one lottery ticket, that seems okay, but, you know, maybe like 50 lottery tickets is maybe more than you want to invest in. It's not an investment, exactly. But he was very urgent about, and, you know, there were, you know, sometimes I think the world is divided into people, and again, this crosses all borders. Some people believe in metaphors, some people believe in signs, some people believe in things in the universe that we don't necessarily understand. And some people don't, and that's okay, but you know, they're just different kinds of people. So he was someone who, you know, there were signs in life. And so a few days before he passed, again, totally, totally unexpectedly, but he very urgently went out and bought many lottery tickets, and I didn't know this until after he passed, and I would find them everywhere, fluttering out of books, dozens and dozens and dozens of lottery tickets, acrostics with lottery on them. So it's strange to think, because there was also a hawk that appeared repeatedly, and you know, we didn't know why. And who knows why, you know, and maybe we're just symbol makers. Right. Maybe that's just what we do. Maybe that's what a poet and a painter make and do. But it's mysterious. Mm-hmm. It's mysterious.
882 paintings.
Yes. He did not, during his lifetime, he painted and painted and painted. He was a man possessed. I, you know, loved and believed in his work. He did not want to sell his work in his lifetime. He said, I don't want to, he wasn't a schmoozer, he wasn't a self-promoter. He said, I don't want to go out there with a portfolio asking people to peddle my wares. He was a very independent man. And I would say, these paintings are so magnificent, people want to see them. And he said to me, you know, baby, people will see these paintings after I'm dead. Mm-hmm. I need to make the paintings. And so he made the paintings. And, you know, we have them on a website. We've had a show. There will be more shows. There is this great legacy left behind of work that doesn't look like. I'm now lamenting and wishing we should have been projecting them here. But you can find them on his website.
Yeah, please do. The work is significant on its own and also in light of Fikri's life. I want to move on to thinking a little bit more about the lucidity of grief. There's a way that you write that urgency is probably familiar to many of us who have lost someone extremely close to us. And I think a lot about it because it resonates for me very, very deeply. And you said you've said in the Huffington Post in an article, the hard part is, do you tell it true? Do you get to the bone? Do you make someone feel they've looked inside your soul and your heart and that a human exchange has happened? And I definitely would say that is so for the light of the world. There's a lucidity and a profound level of clarity that really captures your reader from the moment that they open this book. As with Kahlo's paintings, after she had suffered a tremendous loss, as with the photographer David Harden, we talked about this, and his capturing of things that are ending, especially buildings and institutions like Johnson Publishing and South Michigan Avenue, there's a way of capturing something as it's ending. In which you almost see it again from the beginning, almost from its birth, and that's happening here. Mm-hmm. Can you talk about the courage of writing so soon, and what that did for you, perhaps?
Yeah. Well, you know, so the book came out. He passed away in April of 2012. I started writing the book, but wasn't writing a book. Was just writing, making words in May. The book then came out the following April. And it's now, no, it came out 2 years after that. I wrote it in about 9 months, and it just recently came out in paperback. So I say all that for the timeline to say that in the last year, going on book tour and meeting with people who have read the book, it was very, very wonderful and amazing to be able to meet people who came with their own stories, not necessarily. Some people had the same experience that I did of, you know, losing someone too soon. But there were other kinds of loss and other kinds of loves. And there were a lot of first-generation American young people who were really, really interested in what it meant to come to this country and not become an engineer or a doctor, but become an artist. So many ways that people intersected with this book. And what I had the privilege of coming to understand very, very profoundly is that I felt grateful that I had an art form with which to move through grief. I had myself, I had the purpose of my children, but I also had a way to know what was happening to me, and that was writing. And that then to have something that would be an offering to other people. I'm a writer, that's what I do, that's what I've done my whole life, but never have I so keenly understood what it means that the art that we make is an offering and an exchange. So that's been a very, very, very serious privilege of doing this work. I think also to the lucidity, you know, the kind of good thing for the work about being laid flat by grief is that there was no resistance in me as an artist. So all I could do was bear witness word by word, and all I could do was move with lucidity. There was no energy for artifice. There was no reason to do anything other than tell the truth. Loss is our common denominator as human beings. You know, we don't stay here forever. We will lose people along the way. We will suffer along the way. That is the truth. So how do we find common ground in that truth? And so just a little offering of what it meant to, again, this bearing witness. There are things that now, even when I look back on them, I think I just bore witness with the craft that I developed over a lifetime. So we loved Jimmy Scott's version of the David Byrne song, Heaven. Heaven is a place where nothing ever happens. These days, I picture heaven in a, populated by the umber angels Ficre painted in abundance, but that seems too fanciful. I never truly believed in heaven and cannot manufacture it. Little Jimmy Scott's plaintiveness seems right when he sings, "Nothing ever happens. How better to describe the infinite solitude of the afterlife? When this kiss is over, it will start again. It will not be any different. It will be exactly the same," he sings. "Each kiss is fixed. It is the same long kiss, but it will never change." That is the comfort, and that is the heartbreak. One night at bedtime, Simon, my younger son, 12 at the time, asks if I want to come with him to visit his father in heaven. "Yes," I say, and lie down on the bed. "First you close your eyes," he says, "and ride the clear glass elevator. Up we go." "What do you see?" I ask. "God is sitting at the gate," he answers. "What does God look like?" I ask. "Like God, Mama," he says. Now we go to where Daddy is. "He has two rooms," Simon says, "one room with a single bed and his books and another where he paints. The painting room is vast. He can look out any window he wants and paint. That room has four views: our backyard, the dock he painted in Maine, Asmara, and New Mexico." "New Mexico?" I ask. "Yes," Simon says, "the volcano crater with the magic grass." "Ah, yes," I say, "the caldera, where we saw the gophers and the jackrabbits and the elk running across, and Daddy called it the veldt. Yes, do you see it? And I do see it. The light is perfect for painting. His bed in heaven is a single bed. Okay, it's time to go now, Simon says. So down we go. You can come with me anytime, he says. Thank you, my darling. I don't think you can find it by yourself yet, he says. But one day you will. And that I can only now see that as bearing witness, you know.
I just want to pause and let that moment. There is a testimony here, mm-hmm. I think, to the generative power of love, mm-hmm. because there is a strength that and a tenderness and a fragility also, mm-hmm. That you bear witness to, that you evidence in this work, and also in your reading and sitting across from you. And one of the things that I was thinking a little bit about having you read, and maybe we can wait also until each of the readers here has their opportunity to read it on their own. There is something about your courtship. Mm-hmm. I always think, Li Qing says, as it begins, so shall it end. Mm-hmm. That there's something about your courtship that also speaks to how transcendent this and inevitable this love is, mm-hmm. Between the two of you. And I want to talk a little bit about that strength. I want to talk about the fact that after his death, Fikre appears again, mm-hmm. and almost guides you through some of the grief. I'll just want to stop there and maybe have you say a couple of things about that.
Yeah, and also I'm thinking about the time and thinking about your other movements too, just thinking about some of the other things you might want to put on the table. Yeah, I think that, you know, one of the things that I learned is that even when loss is profound, that the people who have loved us deeply, you don't become unloved. It doesn't go away. And so, as magical as our coming together was, and I would like to say I did deserve it because, you know, I had my frogs along the way. We all deserve it. I don't like it to be too much of a fairy tale, even though it was. But, you know, it was a journey to get to that place. And we had to find each other. But I think, you know, what's really, really important about that force of love is that, you know, a man and a woman came together in short order. We met each other, we decided to get married in a week. We didn't tell anybody, said everyone's gonna think we're crazy. You know, I was really unreliable, having, you know, aired before. So nobody really wanted to hear that I was, you know, gonna marry someone else. But we decided, and we knew, and we moved forward, and then came baby number one, and then came baby number two, and it all moved. And so it was a fairy tale, though a fairy tale to which we committed. But a man and a woman come together, make some beautiful babies, have a beautiful life. If that love force is not multiplicative and does not radiate back out, I mean, this back to generosity and hoarding. So, you know, I really have been thinking so much about how our families change shape. You know, our families are never consistent. Even if you start out in one house, maybe that house changes. Maybe then you're with other people. Maybe then that house changes. I now essentially live with my mom and dad. They live downstairs from me. You know, that's new, you know, after my husband died. So, you know, and that our village, our extended family, because we always lived with open doors, and some of that was being a refugee family. So people needed things, so we were open to them. And they came with their gifts as well. Mm-hmm. Some of it was an artistic, crazy poet principle, like, oh, here's some soup, you know, the poets are here, let's all be around the table. So it's a way that I try to live. But the point is that the magic of, you know, heterosexual love in a family with beautiful babies has got to mean more than just that.
Absolutely.
It's got to be a generative force.
Yes.
It's got to make people stronger. It's got to be open. Or else it's wrong, actually. That's what I think.
So next movement, I want to talk about Derek Walcott briefly. His influence in your life, his influence on the book, your way of seeing, you studying with him. I had a moment, we share a love of Derek Walcott. I had a moment once when I was in college, in undergrad. I loved him so much, I had a postcard, I framed it, I put it in my bathroom. We had a little bathroom in this little crazy apartment that nobody went into. It was kind of scary, but I did. So I put his photograph there. And I told him that at once at a reading. And he looked at me and he says, "Thank you." Talk about Derek Walcott.
Oh my goodness. He was a gruff mentor. I went to him as a fiction writer, but someone who wrote these little things. And I went to him with my Dear Diary, and I opened it up, and I said, like, I don't know, what are these things? And he looked through, and he looked through, and he looked through, and he said, And then he took out a legal pad, and he copied out some of my lines and put line breaks into them. I wasn't writing poems, I was writing stuff. And he said, "You see, you're trying to write a poem, but you don't understand the line break." And then he said, "Leave, child, and write some poems. Don't come back until you have some." So I took my notebook and I went, and literally, like, at that moment, I mean, he told me I was a poet.
Yes, you would go on from that moment to the next movement, Poets and Presidents.
There we go. That was good. She's moving those movements.
That's exactly right. And that was really the goal, the segue. You would go from showing someone your diary and having someone, no less Derek Walcott, say you have something here, to reading the inaugural poem on the occasion of Barack Obama's first inauguration. Can you talk about that moment, and can you talk about the responsibility of poets to presidents, especially in light of this moment right now, post-election?
So we are in Chicago.
We are.
You know, so I think actually just to take a collective moment in this room and send our president gratitude and love, and the first family gratitude and love for what they have given the world and will continue to give the world. You know, these people made by this great city, you know, who have exemplified so much that is just and beautiful and powerful and purposeful. So, you know, when I was asked to write and deliver that poem, it was only the fourth time in history that a poet had been asked to speak on inaugural day. And what I think that it showed us that President Obama understood was that there were things that artists could do, could offer, that political language could not. That there was another kind of language, and it was the poem, and it was Aretha Franklin, and it was Yo-Yo Ma, and it was the, you know, that needed to mark that moment, that the meaning of that moment would not fully be apprehended unless different kinds of language brought it forward. And that's a beautiful thing about multivocality, about the different ways that we know, about what it means to, yes, be a singular person, but to make the moment collective in the way that that campaign was collective. So if you think about the rarity, if you look at President Obama's, you know, language over time, and how infrequently he speaks in the first person, actually, you know, that it's always about, you know, it's not about me, right? It's not about me, but it's about us, and I'm the person who can step forward and, you know, do some things in our interest, but it's always collective. And so that's what I tried to listen for in that poem, you know, coming out of the spirit of the campaign with so many different kinds of people, small donations, big donations, the idea of a real coalition. And so what did it mean to kind of try to be inspired by Walt Whitman and be inspired by Gwendolyn Brooks and think about, you know, I Hear America Singing, and to hear about all of those voices, and to be able to, like Walt Whitman, you know, do I contradict myself? Very well, then, I contradict myself. I am large, I contain multitudes. So to kind of cast your ear across the land, that is what I was trying to do in a voice that was humble And I look now, I've been thinking, I'm going to be reading, there's some people, poets who are going to be reading in New York tomorrow to raise up voices in Washington Square Park, voices of hope, because there's a lot of hopelessness right now. And I was looking back at that poem, Praise Song for the Day, that I wrote, it comes to a point where it asks, what if the mightiest word is love?
Yes.
You know, love that is bigger than national love, filial love. You know, this is what I'm talking about. You know,
right.
Love that casts a widening pool of light. What does it mean to walk forward in that spirit into the unknown? And so it was a really interesting experience for me looking back at that poem and thinking of it not in its occasion only then, but thinking about what it might mean at this moment right now.
And I want to speak to that. Do you remember the opening lines to
each my poem?
Mm-hmm.
Shall I recite it? I
can't just maybe the opening.
Each day we go about our business, walking past each other. See, here I was all big and bad. Each day we go about our business, thank you, walking past each other, catching each other's eyes or not, about to speak or speaking. All about us is noise. All about us is noise and bramble, thorn and din, each one of our ancestors on our tongues. Someone is stitching up a hem, darning a hole in a uniform, patching a tire, repairing the things in need of repair. Someone is trying to make music somewhere with a pair of wooden spoons on an oil drum with cello, boombox, harmonica, voice. A woman and her son wait for the bus. A farmer considers the changing sky. A teacher says, take out your pencils, begin. We encounter each other in words, words spiny or smooth, whispered or declaimed, words to consider, reconsider. We cross dirt roads and highways that mark the will of someone and then others who said, I need to see what's on the other side. I know there's something better down the road. We need to find a place where we are safe. We walk into that which we cannot yet see. Say it plain that many have died for this day. Sing the names of the dead who brought us here, who laid the train tracks, raised the bridges, picked the cotton and the lettuce, built brick by brick the glittering edifices they would then keep clean and work inside of. Praise song for struggle, praise song for the day. Praise song for every hand-lettered sign, the figuring it out at kitchen tables. Some live by love thy neighbor, it's missing a little bit. Some live by love thy neighbor as thyself, others by first do no harm or take only what you need. What if the mightiest word is love? Love beyond marital, filial, national, love that casts a widening pool of light, love with no need to preempt grievance. In today's sharp sparkle, this winter air, anything can be made, any sentence begun. On the brink, on the brim, on the cusp, praise song for walking forward in that light. Yeah. So, you know, the words have a different angle today, but I always hope that they're useful.
I just want to stay on that as we get ready to close, and I'm hoping that you're preparing questions because we are reserving 15 minutes that I could have continuing to talk with Elizabeth for your questions. So get them ready because that's really actually the meat and the fun and the joy of coming together in this way. One of the things I was thinking a little bit about, especially on the so fresh after an election that really has been, you know, a catalyst for lots of different levels and kinds of discussions. I wanted to think about something that you said and ask you more about it upon your appointment at the Ford Foundation as Director of Creativity and Free Expression, mm-hmm. which is the ultimate title, right? You said, as a working artist, as well as someone who studies the historical impact of the arts, I see how art is often what carries forth voices, struggles, and visions that might otherwise go unheard. I want you to talk about that, because I'm thinking a lot about what is the responsibility. The reason why you found your poem is mm-hmm. Because I wanted to go back and look at that poem again in light of its timelessness, what it had to say about today. And the first thing that I thought about is, will there be a poet at the next inauguration? And what, no judgment. And what would be the responsibility of that poet to capture everything that's in the air? So knowing, you know, that you also feel that art is art in and of itself. It is art, and that's its first responsibility. But it also carries and becomes a carrier of struggle, of dissent, of resistance. Can you talk about the responsibility of the poet to the president, or is there one?
Well, I think, you know, when we think about art, I think, you know, people made paintings on caves, right? People have told stories forever. People have raised their voice in song forever. People have found song as a way to say, this is who we are, or as a way to offer vision. So I think that, you know, there's something indelible about art that it's very important to remember. There's something necessary about storytelling, which I would interpret very broadly. I mean, storytelling doesn't always mean, you know, once upon a time. But human beings make stories. Human beings make images. That is something that we do. So I think that, you know, if you think about the kinds of truth and feeling, you know, I mean, I think that one of the things that we did learn from this election, that we should always remember about elections, is that people sometimes would rather feel than think. And, you know, that feeling can be positive or negative. That feeling doesn't have to have an other, but sadly that feeling was given an other, right? So I think that when you think about what does it mean to need to feel, that also takes us to what art, as I, you know, say in my work at Ford, you know, art has magic powers. It has powers that other things don't have. So if we need it, what does it mean to think about lifting up beauty, lifting up power, lifting up vision, you know, making a way for this unremunerated form to at least not get squashed and to thrive in unexpected places, as it does. You know, I don't think that the human spirit and the will to make art can ever be extinguished, but I think that in this interesting adventure that I'm on of spending some time in philanthropy, I'm thinking a lot about what does it mean to lift up this necessary thing in an uncompromised way, in an uncompromised way. Because I think that, you know, one of the things that is very important to remember is that all of those people who elected Obama are still here. I mean, there's a lot of different voices in this country. So I think that, you know, I'm interested, you know, I'm a lifelong teacher, I'm a mother, you know, I'm interested in young people and what light they're gonna look toward. What is gonna be so compelling that they wanna come over and be a part of it? And lifting up those positive forces is what I think art can do.
And I saw a tweet, one of your tweets about your son and his work with the election this year.
I was proud of both boys. Boy number one, 18, went to great, so, you know, we live in New York, he's in college in Connecticut. He's very meticulous, he doesn't miss deadlines. He applied early for his absentee ballot, it did not come to him. Then he, you know, he was frantic, it didn't come. He said, okay, Connecticut has same day registration. He went, he had an exam, he talked to the professor, he waited online, he waited 3 hours, he cast his first vote. And so he did that, and I think that in such a close election especially, I mean, you know, you vote, but in such a close election to feel that you did what you could, he and his friends are very fearful and are very devastated about what this means, but he did what he could. My 17-year-old got on a bus with some of his school friends from New York, and they went to Pottstown, Pennsylvania, and went and knocked on doors and you know, did, he said, we knocked on doors all day, I got 4 people to come out. He said, that wasn't very many. I said, baby, that's not the point. That is not the point, you know. And he saw he was in a neighborhood in a community that was nothing like anywhere he'd ever been before. Mm-hmm. And so to go, you know, respectfully to people's homes and to talk about, you know, they weren't in convincing mode, they were in come vote mode.
Yes.
I was proud of him. I'm proud of him and his friends.
Yeah, me yeah. too. Me too. Kudos to both of them and to you. So now is the time that we are going to open the conversation. As we're going into that, I just want to thank Elizabeth for the time up here. So let's definitely.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, your name?
Demetrius Sajus Brady.
Oh, he was my student. He's a grown up now.
He's so, been a grown up. Yeah, I don't have a question. I just have a comment. I don't have your picture in my bathroom, but I do have your books in my classroom, and I just want to say thank you.
Wow. So thank you.
Got my thank family you. To come out, and so thank
Those
you.
Those the babies?
Yeah.
Oh, there they are.
Wow, beautiful.
Yeah. So Demetrius became a teacher, and so it's an amazing thing when your students become teachers. That is kind of the best thing of all.
Yeah, there's a hand in purple, and then there's another hand in the gray, and so we'll remember.
Hi, I was struck by your comment that you believe people would rather feel than think. Could you say a little bit more about how we can get people to think?
Yeah, I mean, and you know, they're not mutually exclusive, but I mean, I think recognizing the part of people that you know, want to feel. And how to, you know, have that be in a positive space is what I've been thinking more about. You know, how to get people to think more well and to you know, critical thinking. I was thinking a lot about that with the challenge, you know, from all of my years as a teacher and watching the availability of information more and more and more from social media coming people's way. And I'm not, you know, someone who says social media is a bad thing or. But you need critical thinking skills to be able to discern what the sources are that you're getting things from. And so that has become more and more and more of a teaching challenge. You know, I think that I really like Theaster Gates Bank space here. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I think it's really quite amazing, and I'm sure many of you know about it, and you should find out more. But one of the things that, when I visited there, that I saw that he did that I just loved, because the obvious answer is school, education, good education, and so forth and so on. You know, there's talk of abolishing the Department of Education now. I mean, I can't even take us there, you know. But at this bank space, and it's a renovated bank on the south side. And
Stony Island Arts Bank, it's at 63rd and Cottage Grove. No, Stony Island, it's at 63rd yes. and Stony Island.
And so one of the things that they had was a kind of community art history gathering, you know, sort of a Saturday morning kind of thing, like come in and here is an arts educator who will talk with you and in community will talk about, will analyze these paintings. You know, we'll do critical thinking together, anybody come in and we'll talk about what we see in these paintings on the wall. And I think, I want to say the word critical was in the description of it. And I thought, I love that because, you know, of course we all have native intelligence and the ability to look and see things and what good teachers can show you wherever they are in community space or in classrooms is, okay, let's get smarter about that. What does that add up to? You know, in a way that can be very, very, very empowering. So I think that, you know, critical thinking is the key and thinking about spaces, classroom spaces, yes, of course, but also other kinds of contexts where it can take place is one answer.
Okay, and there was a question here, and then afterwards in the shawl. Yes.
Yes, hi, thank you. Two things. First, mm-hmm. I believe, in context to exactly what you just now said, I think poetry can be very helpful for literacy, which is...
Yes.
And if you could speak to that just briefly, and also say something about Gwendolyn Brooks, whose centenary is coming up. Next
yes,
year.
Yes, yes, yes. Well, you know, the thing that I think is so wonderful about poetry amongst other literary forms is that it is the most eternal. You know, the novel actually is not a cross-cultural eternal art form. It's not a very old art form when you compare it to poetry. So what I love about poetry is that it's existed and been important across cultures and across time. So I think that that gives it a great deal of power to reach and be meaningful to people. Human beings, you know, there I'm sure are all kinds of scientific studies around kids and the proclivity to rhyme and rhythm and pattern in the way that it's very, very easy to work with poetry with very, very young people. In the way that we sing to our children and they make rhymes and ask us to sing more. You know, so I think that that way in to poetry, and then, you know, the lesson of poetry is that actually you return to a text because more meaning unfolds. That the first thing you see or know is not the last thing. So contemplation, rethinking, I think that, poetry, we're more likely to be able to read and reread a poem than we are to read and reread a novel, just practically speaking. So I think that those are some of the many ways that, you know, poetry can just do so much for us. Gwendolyn Brooks, the great Gwendolyn Brooks, the last time I was in this library was for Gwendolyn Brooks' 80th birthday celebration, 80 poets. I was so honored to be one of the poet asked to, and I wrote a poem for her on that day. She's the poet who is most influential to me, her work. She was the genius of the 20th century. I love being provocative, and I've done this for many years. I've edited, you know, her work and tried hard to get it out there, saying actually Gwendolyn Brooks is the genius of the 20th century, above Eliot, above Stevens, above, you know, anybody else, and I'll fight you. You know, I can convince anybody of that. She was a genius who wrote about everyday people. You know, and you know, I mean, I'm think I can see I'm preaching to the choir. But you know, I would look out my window. All I had to do was look out my window, and there was a poem. This is from someone who, though born in Kansas, lived in the same 10 blocks for her life. But everything was there because she had that kind of regard for and interest in humanity and language and range like nobody else's. So she's, you know, she's in this, she's really in this building, you know, all the time. And thank goodness we have her work forever.
Yes, yeah. Definitely. And I think you made a reference to next year, 2017, there will be a year-long celebration of the life of Gwendolyn Brooks. It's called Our Miss Brooks 100. So there will be at least 100 activations. So definitely look for an opportunity to participate and to also hear some of the poets, contemporary poets, who have been really inspired, as Elizabeth has, by the great work and the mind, the genius that is and was. Miss Brooks, Gwendolyn Brooks. Okay, I think right over here. Yes.
Hi.
Hello.
I'm Sasha Orange, and I am a librarian, a colleague actually of Tracy in her years when she was a librarian. She's on to something else now. Mm-hmm. And I think I just want to thank you. You really, the thing that I worry about now with what's happening, and we with all of the responses to the post-election, I spent the first 2 days after the election on Facebook, which is sort of my work now, just sort of reminding people and making people feel better about themselves. But I like that the book was a process, because I'm concerned that people want to fix these, and it's not just young people, but they want to fix them, they want to stop them, they want to teach them, they want them to learn. And grief is a process. I mean, just, and your book just showed that to me. My parents died 30 days apart. Mm. I expected them to die. I mean, I was with them. But it took me 3 years to get through that process, to walk through that. And so to expect people who are so shocked to then, why don't they get over it? I was told many times, why don't you get over it? Mm-hmm. They aren't going to get over it overnight. And so, you know, I read your book just before the election, And I thought about it. I have it here before I turn it back to the library. And I'm buying some copies. I'm glad it's in paperback. I'm buying some copies to share with some friends who've had some losses. Mm-hmm. But I'd like for you just to talk about that process. I mean, I think it's unfair. You know, I don't want them going out burning buildings and destroying it. I don't want them doing that. But I think it's unfair to expect them to learn and to listen and to, you know, because they're in pain. And when you grieve...
You mean the young people who are protesting?
The people who are protesting. Yeah. I mean, and they're not just young people. I mean, passed
a whole... I was going to say, I marched on day one in New York City.
Yeah, so. Yeah. But I'd like for you just to talk about that process and... You know, because it worries me that we're pushing them so fast.
I think a couple of things. You know, there are so many different kinds of grief, right? There are so many different kinds of grief. And that's what I was saying, what has been really interesting about writing a book about one thing that happened that created grief, but that there are so many other ways, and that I think that that the never detachable flip side of grief is how much did you love what you lost, right? You know, what do you love? June Jordan, you know, who was a great writer, activist, thinker, poet, when she talked about political activism, she asked the question, where is the love? What is the yes? You know, what are we fighting against? But the enduring thing is, what are we fighting for? And I do think that when there is shock, it does take a minute to recover. So with any kind of grief, one of the things that I've thought about more deeply is respecting. You know, you can't tell my grief is not your grief is not. You know, it's a very peculiar animal. It moves in its own way. And I think that also in general, we have to be so careful about, you know, letting too much crappy stuff in. You know, there's a lot of crappy news and a lot of crappy punditry. So if you listen to too much of it, as I have over the last, you know, few days, you know, and it's like, you have the power to turn it off. Just turn it off. I think that there is this kind of speediness to say, oh, well, you know, here's how we've analyzed it, is this reason. This is what went wrong. This was what it was. Move to the next thing. Now that, you know, being thoughtful and analytical takes a minute. Feeling and knowing and learning take a minute. And I say this as, like, I am fast. But I do think that there are, you know, human cycles, as you say, of grieving, of learning, of knowing, that hopefully, you know, put us in a place where we can each, you know, find and know what our productive communal purpose is and work with what we have toward that purpose.